Well, good afternoon, everybody. I hope you found the presentations and the discussions useful. And from the fact that Vicky's just sitting down, the networking is very productive. and we do encourage, obviously, people to exchange a lot of cards and get feedback on sort of creating these different linkages. And really to carry on the theme that we started, and Geeta is our person who's continuing that discussion from the last session to this, we wanted to talk a little bit about the engagement of private sector. And this session specifically, and I'll just read from the handout we provided you, will focus on which sectors and markets have the greatest opportunity for the IFIs and how in the coming years, global development is shaping the lending and operations of development banks as well. But we've heard EDC mentioned a few times, and we'll talk a little bit about what EDC is doing, and they've got some interesting tools that could help companies looking at international markets. They've got a lot of offices, and they've got other announcements, and I'll get Vicky to talk a little bit about that. But I'm hoping this is going to be much more of an informal discussion and an opportunity really to take what you've heard today and start bringing things together and really setting the context for some of the discussion that we'll have tomorrow. Just some of my other initial comments, I was looking at what the Government of Canada, for example, is really encouraging. And they are advocating to support developing countries, create conditions for strong and sustainable private sector-led growth. And they have a program called Sustainable Economic Growth Strategy. And what they're looking at, and this is through GAC, probably the development arm, is how can Canada help build strong economic foundations? How can they help grow businesses? And how can Canada invest in people? And I think the groups that we have here are some of the conduits to try to get some of these areas undertaken on the behalf of Canada. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go across this way, ask each of our speakers maybe to take 5 minutes or so to give us some points that they want to sort of emphasize under this heading from their respective areas. So Brett, I'll let you sort of jump in.
Great, thanks very much, Shane, and welcome everybody back again. I'll just skate over a couple of general topics. I'm actually really looking forward to the exchange with the other panelists here and questions and comments from the floor. First of all, no big surprise, everybody loves the private sector these days. Certainly the IDB group has made it a growing focus. It set targets, 20% of investments and engagements with private sector development. And of course, that's not just working through private sector delivery agents, but the private sector on the ground. So certainly private sector has become a strong interest within the overall aid architecture as a way to see the critical social and economic development that probably everyone around here is looking to see happen in some way. Some big changes that have happened at the bank that I wanted to flag and the kind of sectors that we might expect there to be greater interest on the part of the bank group. I mentioned earlier that the bank group merged out or consolidated all of its investments and engagements with the private sector into the Inter-American Investment Corporation for reasons of efficiency, effectiveness, better coordination. The IIC has a 5-year strategy in which it's trying to deliver on that mandate. They're actually doing it as a 1+4. The first year is, well, let's just see if what we're figuring out we're going to do is right. And the remaining 4 years is, well, let's just make sure we're doing it. So what they've landed on so far is clearly a focus on small, medium enterprise. And that's not just promoting small, medium enterprise on the ground, but linkages with small and medium enterprises. So you'll find that's a common theme throughout the Americas, and certainly I think even in our own country, where there's a recognition that small, medium enterprise is a big driver of economies and a big driver of growth. Within particular sectors, they've landed on agribusiness is an area where they see potential for growth and further investment in the region. A little bit obvious, one we've heard before too, infrastructure. energy and transportation. And within energy, I would just highlight one that I think all of us are becoming increasingly familiar with, and that is renewable energy sources. And with it, bundled into that, the broader issue of climate change and the opportunity that it brings, renewable energy technologies and the like. There's a recognition that certain regions of the Americas that haven't perhaps got the investment and the attention that was due, small, vulnerable countries, need a greater engagement, particularly when it comes to the private sector. And in the Caribbean, there's a recognition that tourism and the hospitality industry is an area where they would expect to see more IIC investment. So I would just flag that. One that Canada is, of course, very close to, the extractive sector. Just recently, Canada announced a new trust fund with the bank, valued at 20 million Canadian, to promote greater investment and actually greater technical assistance in the area of the extractive sector in the Americas. But it's one the bank, I think, has recognized they need to be more engaged in and seem to be more of a partner on. And just finally, a couple of quick points. On the Canadian side, clean technology and the application of technology by and large is an area where I think there's a tremendous amount of opportunity for Canada. The strengths that we have in ICT are applicable across virtually every sector. And the trick isn't to think of ICT in and of itself, but how ICT and the changes and the opportunities that it brings can be applied to most of the sectors in which the bank is bank group broadly is engaging in. Finally, what a lot of the bank group wants now is your money. There is a huge desire to double, actually almost triple, the amount of additional funding coming from the private sector into projects in the region. The IIC in a loan, the corporation, is about $2 billion a year. They're hoping to get over $5 billion by the end of roughly their capital, well, actually the five-year program. And part of that is reaching outside of their traditional co-lenders, other development financial institutions, to philanthropic supporters, but also to the insurance funds, to pension funds, etc. There's a huge appetite to try to unlock that market. So I'll stop there. As I say, I'm really looking forward to comments from the other panelists and questions, I hope, from the floor.
I'd like to build on, Brett, what you were saying about, you know, the bank wants your money from the private sector perspective. This has been a really innovative model that we're starting to see more recently, and that's the concept of leveraging funds from different donors. So, for example, we have a project in Ukraine, and it's a governance and economic development project. And we are working with the EBRD, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, to channel some of their funds towards some of the initiatives that we're doing, and to create a form of parallel funding so that we can accomplish the initiatives in Ukraine without kind of stumbling all over each other, so that there's more donor coordination, but also so that the EBRD can spend less money on management. So we can handle that, we can handle the recruitment of the experts who will perform the initiatives, the deployment of them, all that nitty-gritty backroom accounting stuff like expense claims and flights and all the stuff that comes with development. And the EBRD can channel 100% of their, or close to, I think we estimated it at 3% was the overhead that would come off of the contribution. And really get a big bang for the buck of the project that we're doing in Ukraine. So that's one initiative that we're seeing. Another area that I'd like to touch on is a model of doing projects and international development that we're starting to see with Global Affairs Canada. And that's the idea of the responsive fund. And we've seen a couple of projects like that. The project in Ukraine is one example of that. And it is very timely. You know, it doesn't follow that model of design a project 2 years ago, then put it out to tender, go through the tendering process, award the contract, then get started, and then you're starting basically on a terms of reference that is now out of date. This recognizes that things are happening very quickly in a country like Ukraine, and that you can be quite responsive, and but still targeted, and you can still achieve results, but in a faster, more nimble way. And we're finding it pretty successful as well. And a great way to meet experts in the country and develop people locally and connect the international development community with the people who are there on the ground. So that's a very impactful form of model as well.
Good examples, and I think we'll come back to some of those comments both you made and so on. Vicky, I think you've been paying people to mention EDC through the day.
Somebody did.
And so we finally actually have EDC speaking officially. So EDC has made some recent announcements that have been very interesting. Maybe I could let you provide some comments.
Sure. Well, we've heard a lot, and good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me and giving me the opportunity to speak to you about EDC. I thank everyone for talking so highly about our accounts receivable and contract restoration insurance program, which are great programs, but I thought I would take a few minutes to also talk about kind of our suite of solutions and other ways in which you can work with EDC to kind of capitalize on the services that we offer to be able to respond to more opportunities and whatnot. So, and then I could talk about a little bit the tools that we also have that I think could be of interest to companies in general, but also the ones that are focusing specifically on developing their pipeline of opportunities with multilateral development banks. So EDC is Canada's export credit agency. We're really there to support and help develop opportunities for Canadian exporters. Just to give you a sense of the type of business that we facilitated in 2014, our business that we facilitated was up to $99 billion in 198 countries for 7,400 Canadian companies. We do have offices across Canada. We've got 17 offices across Canada, 17 offices internationally. And we recently opened an office in London, and later on this year we're opening an office in Jakarta. And these people are really there to meet with interested Canadian companies to talk about what your value proposition is to an international company and how it is that we can support you, whether that means with a financial solution that I'm going to talk to you about briefly shortly, or also just leveraging our network to introduce you to some of the companies that we've financed who may be interested in working with you either as a partner or purchasing your products or services. So we've heard a lot about accounts receivable insurance. That's, a lot of people are familiar with an insurance product. We provide up to 90% insurance on your accounts receivable. So if your buyer doesn't pay you, EDC will reimburse you. Many companies see that as a great risk mitigant, but also that can help you access more working capital with your bank. You're probably familiar, your bank will margin your Canadian receivables more aggressively than they would your international receivables because they're a little bit more hesitant on taking exposure to foreign assets. So by having an accounts receivable policy, you're able to increase the amount of working capital typically that you can access from your domestic bank. Another very interesting product that that we have is contract insurance and bonding. So we talked about providing bids for a lot of these multilateral contracts, which will tie up your working capital. Your bank will gladly issue a letter of credit to guarantee your performance, but they'll also tie up your line of credit for the exact same amount. So EDC provides guarantees to your banks to really offload that requirement to secure your lines of credits so that you have more working capital to respond to other projects. And that goes from the bid to performance to warranty bonds and so on. Guarantees and financial products are also, I think we do a great job of tailoring the product to the need. So we can do, buyer financing. We can provide guarantees to your banks to just increase their amount of capacity to lend you money to respond to international opportunities. We can lend your company money for foreign investments. If you're leveraging Canada's scientific research and experimental developmental tax program, we've got a guarantee solution for that. So a very broad application of guarantees and financial products that if you're finding you're lacking in the working capital to be able to respond to opportunities, you know, I suggest that that you reach out to one of our offices and talk to us. And what's nice about ADC is that we don't compete with your Canadian bank. We're really there to partner with them. And so what we do is really complementary to what you currently have and not looking to crowd anybody out. How we work with IFIs is really mostly on the financing side, so lending alongside a multilateral development bank and a parallel loan in support of a Canadian company. For us, we always need to have that Canadian story. So whether it's an investment or procurement, we really need to have that Canadian mandate in order to participate. And I think what makes us a unique and interesting lending partner is that we are equipped, and you know, we do have six sector teams that monitor Canadian capabilities and understand, alongside with our trade commissioners, what Canadian companies are doing and where they can make a difference. And so, you know, as I mentioned before, by leveraging some of our relationships on the foreign buyer side, if you will, in foreign markets, we're able to make some introduction. And that is a space that ADC has recently decided to make an incremental investment. We've now created a new team called Global Trade Creation Team. We've hired some global trade directors who are industry experts who will solely focus on developing relationships with foreign companies and specifically with their procurement teams. Typically, EDC manages, you know, relationships with foreign buyers at the CFO level, but now there's going to be a subset of that matchmaking component that will really put a lot more focus on the procurement side of things, developing those relationships, and increasingly working with you know, our Global Affairs Canada and the ALIFIs, the PSLOs, to really work that network and you know, maximize the exposure and the visibility that we can bring to Canadian companies. So I would encourage you all to at least make yourselves known to ourselves so that we know where you fit into the various supply chains that that are out there.
Good.
As an intro, that's good.
Or am I working with IFC and then IFC brings EBRD or brings EDC in? So maybe can you just quickly elaborate how, if I'm a company, should I be to ask the IFIs or IFIs to access EDC?
If you're looking for business opportunities or financing support?
Either one. Yeah. Just traditionally, how do you see it working?
I see it coming both ways. Oftentimes we're approached by a Canadian company that says, I'm bidding on a project. I would like EDC support. And one of the tools that we do have is marketing letters. So if you're a major investor or sponsor and you want to include in your bid submission EDC's marketing letter to say, you know what, if we win, our ECA may support us. So I think it's important to make your interest known on both sides. And at the end of the day, if there's a financing gap, EDC will happily fill that gap. But I think,
yeah, that's good. And certainly, you know, don't be afraid to jump in. We want to make this a discussion. So if you have a question, raise your hand so I don't have to ask too many questions myself. You know, one question that Gita, the example you gave with the EBRD and the fact that Agriteam came in with this large project in the Ukraine, what was the reaction of the EBRD? It's not very often sometimes private sector comes in and says, I've got money to put on this on the table. How did that whole process work? If you could maybe walk us through.
Yeah, I think that their reaction was very positive, and it was sometimes coming into a new region can be very daunting to set up an office and set up a management structure and get everything going. If something's already there and working, and you're providing funding, and the mechanism is so nimble that you've got a roster and a database of experts, like we have the roster of experts already in place, And so they'll come up with a concept that, you know, we'd like to do an improvement in the passport office, for example. Then we say, okay, we can source some experts in that area and mobilize them in the next month. And I think that that was very, very appealing to them. So it was very well received. And then they started telling their USAID friends and World Bank friends, and we're hoping that this turns into something that's much larger than just the EBRD. Wow. But we'll see how it goes.
That sounds pretty exciting.
Gita, if you've got $3 billion to bring to the table,
yes.
The corporation would be very happy to have you there, even part of it. But,
yeah, exactly.
And I'm hoping that EDC gives out free iPads every time there's a new loan arrangement or guarantee. But,
are you looking for an iPad?
A couple of extra ones if you have them.
Brett, you were saying something about the trust fund. I thought that was interesting. You know, having a Canadian trust fund in the extractive sector. Maybe tell us how, as Canadians, we should leverage that, or can we leverage it? Because more and more trust funds, or all of them now, are untied. How, as a private sector or a CSO, can I sort of engage those funds?
Okay. Well, that's one point that you raised I want to flag. Trust funds untied. Amongst a number of organizations, that trust funds are tied. In fact, there are, last count, about 70 of them that are floating around the Inter-American Development Bank Group. I think there might be two or three that have tiny, tiny tied elements to it. I think maybe the Japanese, maybe there's a Korean or a Spanish fund in there, but you're quite right. The trend has been to move expectations away from tying. That's hugely important for Canadian organizations. I say that because Canada is a significant trust fund and fund supporter of the bank group. In fact, I think we finally outstripped Japan. We've got a $250 million US fund that supports climate change adaptation, the $20 million CANEF, the extractive sector fund that's just been announced. But that is more than outweighed by the combined total of other funds that exist. Canadian firms are benefiting from them. Consultants are benefiting from them. And we're not putting a penny into them. So the untied nature of the funds is a huge benefit for many organizations around here. Of course, it begs the question, how do I get some? And a lot of that comes back to the original discussion that we were having about make your connections. You're not going to find on too many bank websites an entry point where you can write in and say, dear trust fund, give me money. More often than not, these are funds that are used by bank staff. They're organized often in the context of country strategies, and they're oftentimes used by specialists to close gaps or to help build a pipeline or to help deepen research and knowledge about a particular area, frequently tied to the fund's topic. So you only really can tap into those funds by making the connections that you're going to need to make anyway, by approaching the bank group at headquarters in the field, the countries, the offices, and making it known that you have a capacity, an interest, a function that is of benefit to the bank group and its aims. Coming back to the extractive facility, this is really quite new. I think we finally got the news release out maybe 2 days ago, so you're a fresh set of ears for that. It's essentially technical assistance. It's not tied insofar as there is not an obligation to pull in a Canadian to deliver it. But naturally, Canada has a fair amount of expertise that we would expect and would hope would be leveraged as part of this engagement. So part of it, too, is incumbent upon organizations in Canada to recognize that they should be making those important trips to the field, important trips to the headquarters. And I'll be very happy that it's the INE, I think, is the name of the acronym of the organization within the IDB Bank part of the group that is leading the implementation of the fund. But you'll see plenty. The bank is very good at pushing out information. They're one of the few institutions that still does glossy publications in full color. So I guarantee you, you'll see something at some point in the near future about it. But make it known that you have an interest. Part of the idea behind the fund is to generate, again, knowledge, technical data about what some of the challenges are in the extractive sector, to go a little bit deeper with certain countries that have an advanced or an emerging area of extractives work, the Colombias, the Perus, but on the other side of it, the Guyanas, etc. They're trying to tap and deepen their ability in certain areas. It won't be Canada that decides that. It'll be the bank in discussions with member states, the borrowing countries for that matter, that recognize the need and want to advance on it. So just thank you for the opportunity to raise the trust fund element, because it is a critical role of a lot of what the bank does. But tapping into it really comes from doing the same things that you would do other loan or access. Get to know the people at the bank groups, particularly in the sectors in which you're interested in.
That's good. So maybe a good segue to Agriteam. Agriteam has got an extractive governance project in Colombia. And again, I think that project was Agriteam providing a response to GAC for that particular project. Can you talk a little bit about, Gita, why that might be a good model going forward? And maybe just how, with some of the examples that you have with Agriteam, how did you decide that what to do in Ukraine? You've got the Colombia project, you've got one in Mongolia. And how do you work at trying to put those types of frameworks together for a particular country? We've got a number of groups here, whether it's civil society organizations or other private sector, who probably have some ideas in those countries that they're working, that they've got maybe an opportunity there, but how do I go about doing this? And what makes a good proposal?
Mm-hmm. So in the case of these responsive type projects, it was getting back to that question of, do you feel that having an office in Gatineau made a lot of sense? And that's really what it gets back to, because these are all Global Affairs Canada projects. And so we're based in Gatineau, and in discussions with the program officers in Gatineau, we figured out that there was an appetite to do this kind of work. First in Ukraine, that was the very first project that we did. And that was because we had already had a project on the ground. So that was a combination of being in Kiev and also being in Gatineau and developing that idea of, we could really do some economic development, some governance reform here. This is a place that's changing a lot. And if you put together this type of idea, we think it would be well received. So we had a little kernel, we had a little nudge in the right direction that this would be an idea that might be appealing to Global Affairs Canada. So that's how Ukraine started. We didn't know if it would be successful. We wrote that proposal, we costed it out and put it forward, but in the end there was appetite to do it, and so we went ahead with Ukraine. Following on from that, Mongolia was the same thing. We had one project director, very connected in Ulaanbaatar, and she was aware of the environment there and what type of project could be successful in Mongolia. And so she developed that concept, and again, we weren't 100% sure that it would be successful, but we put together that proposal and put it into Global Affairs. And then someone in Global Affairs heard about that project from the Columbia desk and said, we think we would like something similar. And that's what led to the third. So it was almost like a chain reaction. It wasn't a strategy that we developed and set out to execute. It really happened organically. But there were a number of steps along the way and dots that connected that eventually led to these three projects. This was not a quick process. We've been working on starting on Ukraine. It's been 3 or 4 years. And Mongolia and Colombia were only signed at the end of 2015. So you can get an idea of the investment that you put into these things, the relationship building, the concept development, the personnel, and the thought that goes into developing these types of proposals.
Mm-hmm. You're almost on a run now. Three in a row. It's pretty good. If anybody has a question, just Daryl
Nelson, Nelson Environmental, we're an Edmonton-based company that remediates contaminated soil. My name's not on the roster because I realized last night, close to midnight, I forgot to register, but Shane and Christy were doing that. First of all, Vicki, time for the EDC plug again. I can't say enough good about what EDC does, and not enough Canadians realize the resource that small companies have. We're a project-based company, and our export market ebbs and flows, and every now and again, everything we're doing is outside the country, and then we have a period where we're not outside for a couple of years, and then we land a job where, again, we're outside the country, and we have all our eggs in one basket. And as a small company, we couldn't afford that project to go off the rails. It might be our last. And when I added up the pros and cons of working with EDC about 15 years ago, when we first started doing our export work, I realized, my goodness, by rights, I actually have less risk working outside the country than I do in my own backyard when I add up the safety net and the protections that are there. It was a real revelation for me. It shocked me, and it surprises other small business owners when I explain to them what EDC does. The other thing that I love about EDC is how well you work with the Trade Commissioner Service and how well those two groups work with our provincial colleagues, Rashane and all his people. It's fantastic, this resource that we have and all the different elements that come together, and each of you do different things that are all for our benefit. So hats off. I think the world what EDC does. It makes me feel good about being a taxpayer, what he does. A question, on your global trade creation team, how does this function? Are they based in Ottawa? How does one access them and get dialogue?
Well, thanks for asking, because I did, there's something that I didn't have a chance to mention that I wanted to talk to you about. So I think the starting point is really the Enterprise Canada Network. That it's a platform that we invested in with alongside the Canadian manufacturers and exporters. It's only a one-year agreement. We've recently renewed this agreement with the CME. But basically, it's the platform where we're asking Canadian companies to populate their profile, talk a little bit about their Canadian capabilities, and that's where we're going to start to look for matchmaking opportunities. So as our teams grow out our relationships with the procurement teams within our financing relationship, existing financing network that we have out there, they're going to really look to the ECN as a starting point and add on to, you know, if Canadian companies haven't registered, we'll certainly reach out to our clients and prospects to say, listen, can you please go and fill out? This is a new platform that we're leveraging and utilizing. But I'm hoping that that platform will develop to be much more, where we're going to use it to, you know, add bids, because, you know, we're often presented with opportunities internationally and we really don't know what, you know, we share them with our client base, but it's overwhelming because there are so many Canadian companies and it's hard to keep up with what it is that you're doing and what are the new sectors that you're targeting. So I personally am really advocating for this to be kind of the Canadian, you know, platform where we can upload all opportunities that are available and go and see it on a daily basis, you know, to kind of see what the federal government has come up, you know, has come across in terms of opportunities that you can respond to. So that's certainly the first place you should look at in order to make sure that you're considered for matchmaking. And I guess also on our website, there's a variety of other resources that I would highly recommend. You know, one of which we recently published our Country Risk Quarterly Report, which really maps out where we see, you know, some of the key risk in various markets. There's also a very useful tool in terms of how to pitch yourself to a buyer. When I was a regional manager in the Middle East, I had the opportunity to participate in a full day of matchmaking with some of the major national oil companies. And I was really surprised to see how, you know, amazing Canadian companies, you know, showed up without even looking on the company's website, and you know, you saw the, you know, the similar mistakes that Canadian companies would do, and it's just like, it was kind of an aha moment where we really needed to put it on, you know, share some what we've seen with the Canadian population, because, you know, you're very busy and maybe you don't see that as being a priority, but when you're meeting with a billion, you know, multinational, if you're asking questions things that are already available on the website, such as what are their procurement practices and how can you register as a supplier, you saw the frustration build up as one, you know, company asked after another. And another thing that I've come to realize is that some of these registration processes can take 1 to 2 years before you get a registration number and before you can actually be considered as a potential bidder on their for their request for proposals. So if you know, once you've identified your markets of interest and potential targets, possibly based on the list of companies that are successfully winning contracts with the multilateral development banks, I would encourage you to go on their website and look at what are their procurement practices? Do they, you know, are there documents that I need to fill out? And start that process early, because once you want to bid on a project, it might be a couple of years down the road before you can actually be considered. And I would also encourage you to look at, you know, other Canadian companies. I was out in terms of potential partners and how you could become a partner with them. I find many times we host some of the major Canadian companies, and they're very open to collaborating with other Canadian companies, but you're probably short on time and it's not your first priority. But if you see synergies with what you're doing and what you can offer to another major Canadian company that's successful, that could be a really good partner for you to get into some of these multilateral development bank projects that you wouldn't necessarily have the opportunity to do on your own.
And maybe just a quick plug for Daryl. The only reason we responded to Daryl, he sent us an email at 12 o'clock last night. Daryl's company is one of the exporters of the year in Alberta. And so when Daryl sends you an email, you listen to Daryl.
Also, this is my third time at one of these events with Shane. I've been to Washington, Vancouver with him. Fantastic agenda, Shane. You put on a great show, and every time I learn something new. So I really appreciate it. It's not just a knockoff of what we did last time. So well done.
Perfect, thank you. I think you had a good segue to AgriTeam, because Gita, recall that list of all the partners that you have. And what was interesting in that list is you had the Government of Alberta, you had Conference Board of Canada, you had Care Canada, you've got
some the whole
breadth. Yeah, mm-hmm. the whole breadth of groups from civil society and government and so on. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us sort of how do you build that, and what are the advantages that you saw in having that diverse team? Because a lot of times we think of partners as another private sector, but you've gone sort of outside that.
Exactly. Oftentimes we look at who has downloaded the RFP, and we look through that list and we say, oh, you know what, it would be great to partner with such and such a university. We think that they have the missing puzzle piece in our bid. And then we go on the internet and look up their phone number and get in touch with their business development team, and sometimes it's as straightforward as that. Nice. But what I wanted to add to what Vicky was saying is that with these new responsive projects, maybe there is an opportunity, maybe you have an idea of something that might work in Ukraine, or something that might work in the extractive sector in Colombia or Mongolia, but you don't have a way or a vehicle to implement that. So you might want to get in touch with us and say, I have this idea for an initiative. And these projects are so responsive that they can, in the time frame of maybe a year, you could potentially see that initiative go into implementation. So if you think of an idea and something that you think might work in one of these countries, by all means, contact us directly, contact the EDC. I sometimes receive emails from the EDC saying, there's this company and they're looking to do this. Have you thought about this? Are you aware of this RFP that's out there? And, they'll do some matchmaking with us as well. So another plug for the EDC.
That's great.
Yeah, I'm not gonna put a plug in for EDC. I think they're getting too plugged here, but just on this category of making connections, I will put in a plug again for Olifi. Everyone I've met today, I've mentioned Olifi, and I've mentioned it a couple of times. Again, full disclosure, my wife works with Olifi. But aside from that, it does provide an excellent linkage service too. If in your engagements with any of the Olifi offices, the trade commissioners, let them know that you're interested in partnering up with other organizations. They meet lots of different organizations in different sectors, in different areas that can be complementary to the work that you do. And they're very good at making those connections. I've heard of it myself, seen it myself. And I'm going to put in a plug for something our organization does that builds on something that EDC mentioned, and that is making the connections with other organizations. The IDB group also has a platform called Connect Americas. It's an easy word to remember, Connect Americas. And through Connect Americas, you can also connect to other organizations in the Americas that are interested in doing work. And I'm kind of hoping maybe, Vicky, that your platform can sometimes look into the Connect Americas one and see if there are organizations there that might be useful counterparts for Canadians to push through. And I would encourage others here to consider the website to register. I can make up some numbers in terms of how many have joined. I know it's quite large. But it's been a strong interest, and it's been one of the efforts of the bank has tried to take advantage of new technologies and new efforts to get the word out about opportunities to partner and to make connections. So Connect Americas, I think it's the future.
Yeah.
Clifford? Yeah, I have a more of an administrative question. And AgriTeam Canada primarily is doing technical assistance, consultancy type projects. Is that, that's my understanding?
Yeah, our core work is capacity development.
Right, okay. And there's a lot of these consultancy opportunities across World Bank, IDB, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Many of these consultancies, however, are precursors to larger projects, their analyses for a hydroelectric power plant, technical development of a proposal or a proposal package for an infrastructure project.
Feasibility study.
Right, feasibility, whatever you want to call it, exactly. When one gets involved with a consultancy of that nature, I believe that makes that company who wins that consultancy exempt from being able to compete in the actual construction project. Is that a fact? Is that a correct statement in general?
It's if you were involved in the design of the bid, the design of the RFP itself, mm-hmm. then that definitely precludes
technical
you.
Or
yeah.
administrative or any
exactly.
combination
yeah.
of that.
Yeah, you are automatically out of the running for bidding on that project.
Okay, I was just wanted to confirm.
Feasibility studies, background studies, I think it's a gray area.
Yeah. Good point. What about environmental studies?
Hussein?
Yeah, I think that if there's any question about it, you should ask for a waiver. Mm-hmm. I've had to do that in the past. And they'll clarify it. Okay. It's better to ask than to think that you're making a mistake by asking. Mm-hmm. It's much better to ask, because they'll answer you right away. They'll say, yeah, if you do this, you're out. And if you do it as an individual, it doesn't preclude you.
That's
from just to tell you the answer I got. So I did it as an individual, and then the firm bid it.
And you know that was the second half of that question.
There you go.
And I think Hussein will be covering that tomorrow. And Vicky mentioned even the idea of the process of getting ready for these particular projects, you know, then the CVs and so on. And Hussein will try to provide some insight into that as well. Any other questions? Tomorrow, I'm hoping Raymond and JD will talk a little bit about this nexus between trade and development. And Brett, you know, you wear really like two hats. So you're working for the Government of Canada and IDB. Can you give us a little bit of that sense between where are we sitting on trade and development, that sort of Canadian perspective, but just from the bank?
Okay. First of all, small distinction. Technically, I'm not working for the Government of Canada. I actually had to take a leave of absence. Please, no tears. I had to take a leave of absence from the Government of Canada to get hired by the bank. I'm an actual bank employee. There's a recognition, however, that I'm where I am because I'm working in the office for Canada. So I am, in effect, mindful of what Canada's interests are and its engagements with the bank. And most frequently, that plays out on policy issues and, more often than not, budget issues. So there's the invisible hand of Canada that lifts up our arm to say, no, we vote against any administrative increases or salary increases at the bank. That's the most obvious example. There is, I think, an acceptance that there is a role to play on the trade front when it comes to, but I'm going to come at it in a slightly different angle, which is one that I've seen a more fascinating challenge at the bank group at large, from the bank side of it and the corporation side of it, which is the challenge between risk and return on the financial and the development side. It's one thing that I must say non-borrowers versus borrowers probably tend to have a lot of the most clashes on. We're not the ones borrowing the money, but we're very much interested, obviously, in the financial viability of these organizations, not just the investment. So we want to make sure they have a very stable bottom line. The challenges with a lot of these organizations is they are charged with, they have a mandate to engage in fairly risky environments where the return isn't so obvious. So there is frequently this challenge between how do we ensure that we're having a development impact through these organizations, and not being too mindful of what having that development focus means on the bottom line. It's really a much more of a dynamic tension, I think, now within the corporation, where there's a deliberate effort to try to promote private sector engagement in sectors and in countries where maybe that private sector capacity isn't so much in evidence. And one says, why? Well, for a whole bunch of reasons. Loans may not be available at the kind of tenor or the rate that makes them appealing. So the corporation steps in. But when you start to add to that some of the additional expectations that frankly can sometimes be a little bit dissuasive to some companies and even some of the borrowers. We've referred to them earlier, but the very important considerations one has to give to environmental issues or cross-cutting issues like gender considerations or indigenous issues, these can be quite challenging. But it's an area that, by and large, most people accept nowadays as being equally vital to the development impact that we're supposed to achieve. And I'm just going to loop back. This is an area where, again, I think Canada has tremendous advantage in terms of its engagements with the bank group. We can lay claim to, obviously, our own embedded interest, oftentimes a legal interest, in ensuring that we're respecting environmental norms and even social norms. We can draw on our acceptance, the sort of cultural mosaic within our own country, our history of dealing with Indigenous communities, which oftentimes makes us a very appealing broker and counterpart for a lot of organizations. So I've skated away a bit from your question, but just to say that I think there is an acceptance that they aren't necessarily exclusive, obviously, on the development and trade side. What I see more often now is that the risk-return proposition from organizations that, frankly, are supposed to be making money, it sounds crude to say that, but is supposed to be making money on their development investments. So how do you do that in a way that balances the financial return and what we all hope is the end product, which is poverty eradication, ultimately through development?
You said a couple of things, you know, in terms of working with Indigenous peoples and gender issues, and Geeta, I'm hoping you could sort of flow into that. That's a couple of the areas where I think AgriTeam has also seen a competitive advantage from a Canadian perspective. You've been doing work on gender issues before it became, in a sense, fashionable, and you know, part of the subject matter is looking at. You know, what are the sectors and markets of interest? What are your thoughts about where opportunities are going to be in the future, where groups here should start looking at? You know, as I said, you started a popular subject matter, but what are some of the issues that AgriTeam's looking at that some of these people should start thinking about? Brett, you also said ICT. I think that was a light bulb in my head as well, how you said we should be applying it across sectors. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts, Geeta?
Yeah, I think economic development, for sure, is one of the sectors that is becoming extremely viable, and that can cross-pollinate with a lot of different sectors. You know, you could have economic development with a health focus, economic development in extractives, mm-hmm. and There's a lot that can be done there. I mean, I would say that just as a general area would be an area that I would focus in if I was, you know, looking to develop a new proposal or go off in a new stream.
Then Vicky, maybe I'll sort of extend the same sort of type of thing from an EDC perspective. You've got this new trade facilitation group. where are they going to be focusing on? What are they seeing?
I think typically we look to focus where Canada has a real level of expertise. So ICT is certainly one area that we've recently developed a new value chain, if you will, is where clean tech crosses over several sectors. So focusing on developing a new value chain relevant to the mining sector, because we certainly have a great footprint globally in the mining. Now going back to those companies and sponsors to say, you know, here's some new technologies that you can consider from Canada that will help you clean up the footprint, or, you know, I'm sure you're on that list. And also on the oil and gas side as well. So clean tech certainly is a focus for us. Really, we have, you know, infrastructure, P3, I think is an area that has a ton of opportunities out there and a space where Canada is really well known to do a great job. You know, I think we have expertise in agri-food. You know, I think it crosses over well with the MDB's developmental objectives as well. So, you know, I know I recently attended a presentation where the World Bank's chief economist spoke, and he certainly honed in on, you know, the markets of greatest opportunities as being Southeast Asia, which unfortunately it sounds like the location and proximity to Canadian companies is not ideal, but he certainly felt that was an area of great opportunities, and on the medium term, Africa, you know, not without its challenges, but certainly a market that is underdeveloped and has a lot of opportunities that need to be, need to be addressed. So,
and you just opened up an office in Joburg as well.
Johannesburg, exactly. I did want to take, if you may have taken an opportunity to talk about a couple of other things. I can't help but feel like I need to talk about the developmental financial institution that the Conservative government has mandated EDC and GEC, Global Affairs, to look at developing. For those of you who aren't aware, Prime Minister Harper in 2015 gave EDC $300 million in capital and asked us to jointly take the lead on developing a DFI initiative for Canada. For those of you that know EDC, we operate much like a bank. We operate on commercial principles. We look at credit very much like other commercial lenders, but we have a greater risk appetite when it comes to taking foreign market risk and taking security on the ground and whatnot. This DFI would look different. I mean, I think the idea is to have it a profitable entity, but not being profit-driven and really focusing on having a developmental impact. So certainly this will be an organization that will work very closely with the multilateral development banks. It's something that is still very kind of in its infancy stage. and the framework is currently being developed, but I would encourage you to kind of keep an eye out for what it is that this bank will focus on, the sectors that it will focus on, and how it is that you can contribute to those developmental projects that it will be funding, if you will.
Just maybe on that, you know, up to that announcement, Canada was the only G8 country that didn't have a DFI. Mm. But maybe for people who don't know what a DFI is, can you quickly give one or two sort of statements what a DFI does, because that might, because I'm a few people, yes, tell me what that is.
Yeah, well, I mean, maybe Brett is better positioned to talk about this, but to me, a DFI is really mandated for developmental work to aid, you know, a foreign market, and is not, you know, perhaps it's grant money, perhaps it's a, you know, with interest. I'm not sure exactly what that model will look like, but it's certainly not a bank or an organization that operates like a bank. It's more of the developmental impact and that it could have in an impowered or emerging market. Brent, would you like to add?
I think you've done a fair enough job of capturing it. And until I get hired at EDC and have to develop it, I'll just step back and let you guys figure it out. Yeah. But
I'm not leading this project at all. It's being led by another gentleman, Etienne Grad, but certainly if you have an interest, I can connect you with him. And I just thought I would mention it because we are being mandated to kind of help develop this DFI, and I think it would be, I wanted to mention it for sure.
It could be, it's an important tool. essentially, it's an institution that can provide equity capital to a particular project. It helps position the Canadian company or Canada on that particular project by saying that we could bring some money to that activity. And it's usually a low cost or grant institution that, again, when you're going to a country on an infrastructure project, and Suresh and Carl, you probably have come across competitors who come in with a DFI. It helps create a little bit of a level playing field. So I think that that's, especially for infrastructure projects, I think it's going to be an important tool. So we've got a couple more minutes did you have any more? You had some more stuff.
I guess last but not least, one thing that I wanted to mention is the idea of the Canada account. Sometimes EDC is approached to say, you know, we understand EDC has this Canada account. We want to know how we can leverage it. As I mentioned, EDC operates on commercial principles. So we'll look at a project, we'll look at the project risk, the technical capabilities, the financial model, and see whether or not we're comfortable with the risk elements of the deal. If we're not, we'll turn it down. And in some instances, Canadian companies, if they feel that the mandate of the project and the benefits either for Canada or, you know, for future opportunities for this particular project, or for this particular company, or the impact in an emerging market is so substantial that they feel they have a case to be made, they can approach the government, the Canadian government, and see whether or not they can tap into this Canada account. And basically this is federal money that would go to backstop anything that EDC would do to support this project. Recently, I know of a Canadian company that have approached us to support an opportunity in Ukraine. We're not currently supporting, new business in Ukraine. We're holding our position, and we've been asked to consider. So at the end of the day, this is something that you need to explore with the federal government, but I think it marries well with the developmental, you know, subject of today, in that if there is an opportunity that is beyond our risk tolerance, there is kind of a plan B. But this is something, I mean, I've been at EDC for 16 years, and I think I've heard of it being used twice, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not something that is regularly tapped into, but I also wanted to mention that it is there.
Great. Well, JD, you had your hand up?
I guess.
Speak now, or?
I shall. All right. So, in the development world, when I was, little background story, when I was in university, I had a bumper sticker on my desk said, "What in the world isn't chemistry?" And it's true, right? Like, chemistry. But in the development game, what in the world isn't governance? Right? It's all about governance. If you have the answerability, the accountability, public voice, the other things will take care of themselves. It would seem to me the future of global development in the private sector is intellectual property in the sense of what does Canada bring to assist developing nations to improve their governance controls, their regulations, everything else. It's going to be less and less, I think, goods and works in the sense of building roads, in the way of Canadians building the road, right? We're not going to ship heavy equipment down there to build a road and ship it back again. We're going to try to find a local partner that has the heavy equipment. We'll partner with them, and we bring the technologies, the approaches, the fee structure, the PPP approaches. It's those kinds of things that I would see to be the key entrance into developing markets. And I hear a lot about Jim Balsillie always talking about the lack of, an innovation strategy in Canada. We have science and technology, but that we confuse the innovation as being the science and technology, not how to use the science and technology in innovative ways. So, in going forward, I would also encourage us to think about what we have as intellectual capital to bring to a project more than building the road, but what do we bring as a development tool to a country? And it's not a development in the sense of going in there and redeveloping work, it's building capacity in a country, helps them achieve their development objectives in a commercial basis.
I think Suresh wants to build the roads, but...
I appreciate that.
No, I will help them to build the road. But together we will, okay?
But no, it's a good point. You know, I think a number of years ago, someone at the bank said, you know, Canada, what you have, what you're selling, you're exporting is gray matter. You know, it's not the tools, but really the philosophy. And I think Agriteam, you're a good example of that as well, in terms of governance is really also what you're doing. Any sort of comments to JD's question?
Well, maybe in a small defense, somewhere at the bottom of my scribbled notes of paper, I put down financial sector. I had meant to actually talk about financial sector reform and a critical role that Canada can play in that area. In some very informal discussions and meetings we've had, that's jumped out as one that the region can certainly benefit more from Canadian skills. The larger challenge is how do you get that there? And there is some appetite on some countries, the Pacific Alliance countries, the Chiles, Perus, Colombias, etc., that recognize that the Canadian market, the Canadian approach, the Canadian system, gee gosh, is pretty darn stable, and that's something that they should consider looking at. You know, it's a bit of a head scratcher if the country doesn't want it and if the bank isn't inclined to promote it. Then part of it is, again, we've got to learn to do a better job of delivering those ideas and that capacity, which brings me back to the inevitable, please come to DC with your ideas. Bring them to the organizations, bring them to the bank, push the abilities that we have. But anyway, I just wanted to put in a plug for my own ideas because I had written it down, and thank you for landing on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd just like to add that we're at a very unique point demographically, where when you look at all the baby boomers who are now retiring, here is a massive brain trust of people. We've got like retired principals who have a lot to offer on the education side. We have hospital administrators, you know, and I think it's about connecting all of these different resources, because you're right, it's we're exporting gray matter, and it's right here.
Well, you know, I think we've probably come to the conclusion of our sessions, and I think on that last theme of Gita, of building connections, I think this is what this day has been about. And that's what I think we're going to obviously try to do that tomorrow. A number of the people here are going to be available for one-on-one meetings in the afternoon, but Hussein's going to start putting some of the pieces together from what we've learned today. First, thank you to our presenters here. I thought it was a very good discussion and helped bring some of the thoughts that we had today together. So Brett, Gita, and Vicky, you know, thank you very much for your contribution this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.